So this is, I think, a conventional wisdom I think most of our grandmothers knew. Sometimes we need to reinvent the wheel. And of course, this is a slide compilation. Some are taken from Dr. Jason Fung and other free sources here. Just to understand why does weight gain occur, we'll go through that. And what are the myths and facts of, you know, so-called calorie restriction we all talk about. And of course, metabolism and health. And what are the possible solutions? Well, this is not about people who don't have much problems, because some people, like who have got, say, a known problem, endocrinological problem, probably are not a part of this talk. And of course, there are around 15 to 20% of people who have excellent metabolism. Whatever they do, whatever they eat, whatever they, you know, drink, they are having excellent health and they never have any problem. They don't put on weight. They live long and they stay healthy. But I think this presentation is about the rest of us who have challenges with weight. And I'm sure a lot of us have. Well, this was me very much on September 1st week 2016, 78 kilos with strings of 160 mg per dl, HDL of 40, waist 94 centimeters, HbA1c of 64. Ultrasound recording showing fatty liver, grade 1 to 2. Well, I knew this 66.4 glycerated hemoglobin is considered a pre-diabetic. My dad being a diabetic, my elder brother is a diabetic, my elder sister is a diabetic. So then I said, I'm at the threshold of becoming a diabetic now. What can I do to come back? What should I do? I consulted a few of my endocrinological friends. They gave me the classical advice. See, you should not eat fat. You should take small meals, frequent meals, you know, and then you should lose weight. Then I said, let me just research and find out. And in this process of my research, I have developed a lot of insights, which I thought it would be great to share with you people. And it's my personal journey, and what happened later. From 78, I have come to 63. My tricks have gone to less than 60. HDL has increased to 62. Waist has come to 81. The biggest advantage is all my old wardrobe I had to throw away and buy a new set of clothes. I mean, that's the greatest incentive. That's probably the greatest incentive. And my glycerated hemoglobin has come to 5.1. And fatty liver completely gone. This is my journey. And the insights I've developed during this journey, I would like to share with you. See, we all fraught with common beliefs that weight gain is synonymous with fat gain. To an extent, it is true. You eat more food and spend less energy. That's how you become fat. And so, solution is move more. You should spend more calories than you consume. And that would translate into weight loss. So much so that people calculate depending on the gram of protein, gram of carb, and a gram of fat. And the caloric equivalent and tell you that this is where you gain, this is where you lose. A calorie. Okay, tonight I had a big ice cream, so I will skip my dinner. Because see, ice cream has got so many calories and I have had those calories, I will skip my dinner. That's, most of us think that way. And typically, calorie in, calorie out. What is this? First law of thermodynamics, you know? That's where, you know, you get the weight. And then, there's a big fat that the dietary fats are not good for health. And they clog the coronary system. This is one of the biggest, you know, fears each of us have. And today outside at the breakfast, we have egg white and egg separated with complete egg omelets. You know? People who are health conscious take only egg whites. They don't take the complete egg, you know, because that yellow has got cholesterol and that's not supposed to be good. And too much fat, no? That's how our egg white is pure protein, so let me take more protein. That is how most of us think, and that's how the systems are. So somehow I have to reduce eating. Yeah? Eat less, exercise more. And that's what I've done for the last 10 years, in spite of being winter weather. I used to go to swimming every day. I used to swim almost 1 hour every day, to the extent that in Jan, that swimming pool fellow said, "Look, sir, I will refund your fees. Nobody else is coming. I can't just run the pool for you." So, see, that is how dedicated I was. Every morning, 6 o'clock go, 6 to 7 swim. But what happened? Nothing happened. My tummy has been the same. My glycated HP was the same, and nothing happened. So why? See, I'm doing exercise. In fact, last night, one of our Amit has gone done 5 kilometers run, you know, exercise. He feels good. But you know, is that important? Well, we'll come. So this is a problem. And this gym guys, you know, so they all convince you to pay yearly membership. You understand? Because they know from 5th day you are not going to come. And they're all happy. You know, this is the popular one. What keeps happening? Right? So this is the paradigm which we are looking at. See a balance. Calorie. And you know why you have got fat? This is your behavior, man. You are a swamp. You are not moving. You are just hogging, and you are not moving. See, this is how the popular culture is. In fact, even well-renowned endocrinologists say that this obesity is behavior. Well, I beg you. The first guy who has spoken about this is William Rankin. He said, the first person who wrote a treatise on obesity, he called it corpulence. Corpus means body, you know, corpulence. He says, you avoid the fattening carbohydrates. That's what he said. And it has taken a long time before this wisdom has come to us. But let me tell you what happened subsequently. What is the current advice? You go to a dietitian today, you say, "Look, I want to lose weight." They say, "Look, wait, calorie in, calorie out, you have to restrict calories. Calories are really important. And you have to include healthy grains in any diet program because grains are good. Don't skip breakfast. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day." How many guys have heard that? I'm sure every one of you have heard this. Breakfast is the important meal of the day. Never skip breakfast. Otherwise, you will binge later in the day and you will consume so much of food that, you know, you will bloat it. Next. Take low fat diet. You know, this fat you take goes and clogs your digestive system. You should take fat, less fat, and you have to sort of control your fat intake. Because, you know, fat is calorie dense. You take more fat, obviously, what will body do? It stores. So you become bulky. Exercise more. That's it. This is the current advice which we'll give. We'll examine each point one by one. There's another beautiful advice. I think this also I'm sure a lot of you have known. Eat small amounts. Don't take chunks, you know. Have breakfast, have a midday snack, have lunch, have an evening snack, have dinner, have a night snack. Eat small amounts, more frequently. I'm sure all of you have heard this. This is the standard advice. And this is basically a recipe for disaster. I'll tell you why. There is a vicious cycle of under eating. Once you cut calories and cut fat, what you have to do? You initially tend to lose weight. There is automatically body senses some problem. It reduces the energy expenditure, your metabolic rate comes down. And then even with that, Initially, we make a decision to lose weight. We work hard. We join a gym, you know. We cut back on food. There is success. Hey, your friend says, look, boss, you're looking slim or not? Good. Yes, sir. That creates cheer you and happy results. Okay, good. Then suddenly what happens? You work hard. But then you won't get that much of a result compared to what you had done earlier. पहले तो अच्छा रिजल्ट आना था अभी क्या है थोड़ा स्टैग्नेशन की हो गया है then suddenly you feel so crappy यार ये एक करते मेरा छह महीने हो गया है यार you know you feel अरे कुछ तो कर रहे थे suddenly one day you feel क्या यार ये जिंदगी क्या जिंदगी है what is this without eating what I want to eat you have only one life and see look at this what is happening you know and then slip. And that becomes a big moral problem. Shit, I have really, you know, committed a sin, you know. And then you naturally gain the weight back. And again, at one fine day, you gain back. And this vicious cycle keeps going on and on and on. Well, let's see what happens if one really overeats. Well, this study could be done now, but it was done by this doctor called Ethan Sims. In 1960s, in United States prisons, because it is probably not ethical to do these studies now, where he has force-fed the prisoners and found out how things have happened, how things look, and he, to his surprise, has found out most of the weight they have put on, they lost over a period of time, and they just. Body, especially when you are eating poor foods, there is something in the body which where you don't really gain. You gain weight again, you come back. It is working something like a thermostat. Then we'll see why exactly this has happened. See, this gentleman is Ansel Keys, where he has promulgated his famous diet heart hypothesis. In his diet heart hypothesis, he said that nitrate, fat, cholesterol leads to cardiovascular disease. And in that age group, in between 60s and 70s, because of smoking and other lot of other issues, there is an increase in cardiovascular mortality in the US. That's when people thought that maybe fat is important. And he did this seven-country study where he, cardiovascular deaths versus the fat consumption here. He put a graph and then he said, as the fat consumption increased, cardiac deaths have increased. This looks like a convincing argument and everybody believed that. But as you see, according to modern methods of research, you should have also kept fat as constant and you should have taken carbohydrates and done the graph. So basically, and here he had done study for 22 countries and only seven countries have been able to be made into a graph, and so you used only 7 countries. So this is a highly flawed study, and somehow this has been accepted for some reason, and that's where this food pyramid is born. And this food pyramid, somehow whatever gets accepted in US goes all over the world. And then what he said, suddenly this fattening carbohydrates have become the daily foods, then fruits, then cheese, and muesli. Yeah. So you can see that they have professed eating these carbohydrates regularly. And then this industry lobby has come. We will come to it later. But then see, that's what I'm saying. If you see a big queue at any mall, at any station, suppose if I'm asked you to troubleshoot, why there is such a big queue? Like if somebody goes and finds out, look, doctor, there are more people coming into the queue than going out of the queue. That is why the queue is long. Will it help in any way to solve the problem? It will not. It is like that. More calories in, less calories out. You gain weight. This is something like it doesn't solve the problem. If you have a plane crash, if I ask you why there is a plane crash, it's like saying the lift and the gravity. Gravity is more powerful than the lift, so that's why it has crashed. Does it help to solve the problem? No way. problem you have to solve exactly at where is the bottleneck. You cannot generalize and make a statement and then be happy about it. This is a cruel hoax. The last 35 years, every one of you must have tried cutting down calories, lost weight, and again regained weight. And what happened? Every time once you cut down your calories, you have adaptive mechanism, reduce energy, you feel cold, and you know, it doesn't really happen. This is the problem with the low fat and the calorie restricted diet. And this invariably has to change. And who is the culprit? Actually, human insulin. Now this is where human insulin is such a powerful and a strong hormone, and it is essential for our life and existence, because cells of the body will not be able to use glucose without insulin. But the problem here is we mess up with our mechanisms and then we create problems with insulin. And it is why. Now this is where we come to the hormonal theory. Why we get obesity? Basically, fattening carbohydrates increase the insulin levels, which leads to obesity. And because obesity is there, you cannot, you don't exercise and you eat too much. We do not get fat because we overeat. We overeat because we get fat. Calories are primarily pushed into storage, leaving inadequate amounts for energy expenditure. So you feel hunger more frequently. And you know, overeating and underactivity are the result but not the cause of obesity. So there is a problem with the signaling in the body. Let's find out what. Then the next question is, what is driving the insulin levels? And you know, with raising insulin levels, insulin has a direct effect on the cortical, the pituitary and adrenal cortical axis, and it increases the secretion of cortisol. What happens? What is driving? You have fattening carbohydrates, insulin levels, obesity, and so-called what we are, you know, talking about, overeating and other activity. And the absolutely crucial question is, obesity is not how many calories I am eating. Calories are largely irrelevant. Increased caloric intake will be matched by increased expenditure. More calories in, more calories out. Answer is the fattening carbohydrate. Insulin works like a thermostat at a set point. And insulin tells the body to get fat. Calories and energy expenditure are adjusted to meet the goal. So that is why whenever people start gaining, losing weight, they again try to come back to the original weight where they have started. That is because of the insulin. Insulin is such a powerful hormone. We have four hormones balancing insulin: glucagon, cortisol, epinephrine, and growth hormone. These are known as counter-regulatory hormones. And then this is a recent addition to us, is high fructose corn syrup. Well, this is a beautiful, because of the lot of concessions given to the agricultural industry in America, this is abundantly made, and people are making more use of the corn and try to make this high fructose corn syrup because it is cheaper, sweeter than glucose. It, you know, whatever the preservation is very good with this. It keeps the breads brown, it keeps them soft, and this is the biggest way. And most of the processed foods, especially low fat foods, have this. Because of the fact that the fat is dangerous, what the food industry has done is, it has started removing fats from the diet. The moment you take away fat from the foodstuff, it becomes stale. And to make it palatable, they started adding sugar. If you look at it, whatever processed foods which are available in supermarket are studded with sugar, because natural fats are taken out from there. And what happens with fructose? You know, fructose consumption has been increasing over and over these years. And what is the problem? This fructose is, can be only metabolized in the liver. And that increases insulin resistance and that causes hyperinsulinemia. So fructose has to be avoided at all costs if you want to control hyperinsulinemia. So what happens here? resistance, increased insulin cortisol level leading to obesity, high triglyceride level, hypertension, diabetes, fatty liver. This is what we call as a syndrome X or metabolic syndrome. And that is how the things keep going up. The most important currently is fatty carbohydrates and fructose. They are the ones which cause. This is a slide I've taken from Dr. Robert Lustig's very popular YouTube lecture, which has got more than 3 million views. The video is called Sugar, the Bitter Truth, where he has said a can of beer and a can of Coke actually do the same metabolic damage to the body. Mind you, a can of beer and a can of Coke do the same metabolic damage to the body, where you happily give this to your child, but you don't give this. The entire amount of fructose, basically alcohol and fructose are very similarly metabolized in the body. Even alcohol needs to be metabolized only in the liver, when fructose is metabolized in the liver. Whichever, the liver is such a complex and a beautiful structure that it is the major detoxifier of the body. And then you see, they have the same damage. And this leads to alcoholic liver disease, and this leads to fatty. Basically, you know, the similar damage, both of them. This is what has happened, the toxicity of refining. Because the foods have to be sold in supermarkets, and they have to stay on the shelf for a long time. So what happens? So they add removal of fat, removal of fiber, then they add all these vegetable oils, and then, you know, they really, you know, they stay, they can be shipped across. You can have one factory which manufactures these foods, and they can be shipped all over the world. And junk food is highly processed. Basically, what does processing do? Processing, what it does is, it just makes the food far, far easily digestible. And then what happens is, as soon as you take it, it is absorbed. And the problem is, for these medicines, for these foods, there are no satiety hormones. The internal mechanisms don't work. Human body has evolved over 2.5 to 3 million years eating natural foods. That is 99.5% of human history on the earth. And we, only in the last 5,000 years, more in the last 200 years, are subjecting human body to all these artificial foods for which there are no feedback control. You can have 1 liter of Coke followed by a full biryani in the evening. You don't know. You can have a full tub of popcorn with a full Coke in the movie. At the end, you still are hungry at the end. This is why. Because there is no satiety signals available for these artificial man-made foods. And these are the ones which drive obesity. Now, fattening carbohydrates lead to insulin level. And coming to fiber, in nature, other than in honey, wherever sugar has been there in nature, it is always with fiber. You look at sugar cane, we extract the juice and we throw away the fiber. Look at the juices, orange juice. You extract the juice and you throw away fiber. So there is an inherent mechanism, like eating fruits is okay, but you should eat whole fruits, not juices. Because juices means you have taken away the fiber. What does fiber do? It retards the absorption and it helps with the insulin. High insulin levels cause insulin resistance. Obviously, it's like any other hormone. Lower levels works effectively. In higher levels, because the more tissues are, you know, getting affected, you need to give more drugs. It's like any other situation. Like if somebody is taking, say, a morphine or another narcotic, to get the same high, later on he needs to take more and more because body tends to adapt. And that makes, that beats the pancreas in secreting more and more insulin. And you know, That's what is happening. Now, body, now let's review the fact. Body acts like a thermostat, not like a caloric scale. You know, obesity is hormonal, not caloric. Insulin and cortisol are the primary drivers which cause weight gain. Exercise, though important, is not at all important for weight loss. Running, swimming, aerobics, no way, they are not going to change anything. Now, what about these hormones, ghrelin and leptin? See, ghrelin stimulates, appetite stimulator, and leptin. Leptin is secreted by our fat cells. You know, what does leptin do? Leptin goes upstairs and tells the hypothalamus that, look, there is enough, we are all happy. Don't, ask for food. But what we do? We put in so much of carbohydrate, which gets converted into fat, and too much of leptin is secreted in the body, and then body, as usual, gets leptin resistant. So we just screw up our signal system on us. This is what happens. So you gain weight, as you gain more fat mass, the number of fat cells increase, the fat stores, develop so much leptin, and there is a signal disruption. And when there is signal disruption, is when you overeat. It is not a behavioral problem, it is a signaling problem. Each one of us are affected by the signaling problem to some extent or the other. People who are more affected have bigger tummies, people who are less affected have lesser tummies. That's all. And then, that is very good. Now, coming to de novo lipogenesis. Basically, dietary fat does not encourage de novo lipogenesis. De novo lipogenesis means the endogenous production of fat from excess carbohydrates we take. Suppose if you are taking adequate fat, usually endogenous triglycerides are not affected because drinks are usually the energy, they give energy. Basically, they are utilized by muscle. But then what happens to carbohydrates? They secrete insulin and then they sort of become fatty livers will be there. And then if people must be knowing a particular dish which is popular in Europe called foie gras, France. Foie gras means fatty liver of the ducks. What they do is they put high corn mash, starch, force feed it through the duck, and then because of that, they get fatty livers. And it is used as a delicacy. And what are we doing? We are doing the same here. Putting cornflakes into our body and making high refined carbohydrates into the body and making our own fatty liver, what we call as a human foie gras. Remember, each one of us know this, but the fats which we consume are directly taken up by lymphatics and delivered directly into the systemic circulation via thoracic duct. All of us know that. Dietary fat doesn't go to liver. In fact, these chylomicrons, which are made by intestine, their half-life is just 3 to 4 hours. After that, chylomicrons disappear. And then liver starts another process of doing lipoproteins. Of course, that is beyond the scope of this lecture at this moment. But fat doesn't go to the liver. And eating fat is not toxic to the body. What is toxic? Carbohydrates are toxic. They need to be processed in the liver. And only then, they are utilized for further purposes. Look at them. If at all the primitive man, what he has eaten, what did he eat? He eat only 1% of grains. Rest of it is all vegetable, legumes, tubers, non-processed carbohydrate. And look at what we are eating, almost 59%. The more whiter the rice, more austere it is, you can see that. And all these foods we are eating, essentially these carbs, these are the ones which are creating problems. And of course, waist circumference, blood sugar high, blood pressure, serum lipids. These are all metabolic syndrome. So basically, we are landing into a metabolic syndrome ourselves, unknowingly, and with poor advice from our own medical doctors, who probably do not think this through. Now, what happens to all this fact? What exactly does this contain? This is what we call as a visceral fact. And that is what will go down the moment you control your dietary carbs. And this visceral fat behaves differently compared to the routine subcutaneous fat. Routine subcutaneous fat is protective because if somebody stabs you, you know, it has to go through the subcutaneous fat to reach the inner viscera. So it's protective. And subcutaneous fat is the last fat to go. The so-called liposuction street subcutaneous fat. It is only for body sculpturing. It has nothing to do with weight gain, weight loss. And subcutaneous fat is protective, it is good. What is dangerous here is the visceral fat. Because visceral fat behaves like an endocrine organ. It starts secreting cortisol. It starts secreting estrogen. That's why you see people with lot of obesity also develop breast. That's how it happens. And this is the metabolically most active and the most dangerous fat. And thankfully, this is the first fat to disappear when you control your carbs. So this is the famous, I think, Amandeep has gone, but Amandeep has taken the name of Yagnik. You know, he's Yagnik here. So what, there is a popular, he's John Yudkin and Yagnik, Chitrang and Yagnik. This is a paradox here. Unfortunately or fortunately, we in Asia and India have got higher body fat percentage with this for the same body mass index. Everybody knows body mass index, weight by height squared. But then for the same body mass index, like though this guy looks leader, but he has 21% body fat, whereas this guy has only 10% body fat. That is the problem because Europeans and other people have got, by nature, they have less body fat than Asians. So we are actually at a higher risk. In fact, a lot of my colleagues tell me, for threshold for bariatric surgery, you say BMI of 35 in Western population, but only 33 or 32.5 in Asians. Because they say that the metabolic effects are more in Indians. So this is another point which we have to consider. And even in my personal story, when I started, I was having 33% body fat, and now I'm only 22% body fat. Still, I'm not ideal. I should be, say, less than 20, according to the whatever literature level. But then, Asians, it is difficult, because they are genetically programmed like that. There are many hypotheses, drift gene hypothesis, XYZ, that's beyond the scope of the literature today. So now what we have done, they come with this drug called Orvastatin, say they will, you know, stop the fat absorption and fat will get secreted out through gut and then you can lose weight. What are we trying to treat? The problem is somewhere else. Kahi pe nishana, the problem is somewhere else and you are treating something else. This is how things are. And you go to the doctor, they tell you, growing by bypass and bariatric surgery. Such a beautiful machinery evolution has given us over 3 million years. Why do you want to screw it up with these artificial devices, sleeve gastrectomies? It just doesn't make sense. Now, I just digress a bit and talk about it. There is a very, very common advice that people, especially diabetics, they say rice is bad and wheat is good. Actually, it is good. Wheat is far worse because wheat has got amylopectin, which is far readily absorbed. And you will be surprised to know that eating direct sugar will not elevate your blood levels as much as eating bread. Eating bread would skyrocket your blood sugar levels compared to eating sugar directly. That is because of the easy digestibility of these stuffs. And you know, and when we particles. You know, they get just absorbed like anything. All fast foods, all junk food are made up of these. And what they do, they just spike your insulin levels up and you are left high and dry. You become hypoglycemic. You would have seen, when you go to the hotel, initially they put some bread there in the front. They all know this. You eat bread initially as you order for your food, and by the time you order for the food, you see the food, you feel this is not enough, and then you ask for more. This has been a very common event in a lot of situations. What these breads do is they spike up your insulin so much, and then by the time you know the food comes, you feel you are so hypoglycemic and so hungry, you feel no, this food is not enough, probably I need to eat more and you order more. This is what happens. And you know, the sugars and wheat stimulate the same areas of brain as narcotics do. So this is some sort of a reward mechanism happening, because humans have evolved through these years. We have no clue. When we have no regulatory mechanisms for these refined foods. Like all these comfort foods are essentially made up of wheat and highly refined carbs, sugars. And then look at the classical grinder versus the modern machine. The food is pulverized with very fine material, very easy to digest, which are easily absorbed and they just push insulin levels high. What we are treating here, we are just looking at this dyslipidemia, hypertension, obesity, but what is there under this big iceberg? It is insulin resistance. I'm not talking about athletes or the 10% of people who have got excellent metabolism, because they do well anyway, probably they utilize carbohydrates very efficiently and they never become fat. I'm sure few of people are here who may belong to that category. But I'm talking about the rest of us who have expanding waistline, obesity, metabolic syndrome. And this is the problem. Insulin resistance is a problem. So here we have fatty carbohydrates, super carbohydrates, fructose driving the metabolic syndrome. And once you cut fructose, fatty carbohydrates, we can sort of control the process. How can we fight this cycle? Well, there are two techniques. I would now will concentrate on the solution. I'm talking about intermittent fasting and their variants. Well, as I say fasting, you may feel, what is this guy saying here? If I don't eat, I can't just manage. If I don't have breakfast, it's very difficult for me to sort of survive through the day. Well, you may be correct, but there are some things which I would like to put forward to you. Fasting is a part of our culture. If you ask every Ekadashi, what you call it, Marathi, Ekadashi, and Purnima, people used to fast. Right? And all 9 days before Navratri and before Sri Ramnavami, people used to fast. So we have so much of fasting culture with us in classical Hinduism. In Islam, you have Roza, a very popular, every devout Muslim does fasting during the period of Ramadan. 1 month of fasting they do. So it is a part of our culture, and whenever we want to do something, it should rather become a lifestyle habit than a fad. So I'm not advocating intermittent fasting as a fad. I'm asking you to take it into the lifestyle so it becomes easy. Because our ancestors have given us the life as a cycle of fasts and feasts. We have forgotten the fast and we have taken the feast. And we have adulterated all the fast with so much of alpahar, light foods we eat during fast. But then what's the problem of fasting? This is what we have done to ourselves. And then we have another way of going about it in the low carbohydrate and high fat diets and their variants. Of course, a lot of people know about it. These LCHF diets are sometimes known as the paleo diets. They are also known as ketogenic diets. These are variants. So these are the two ways one can go about solving this problem. Our food should be our medicine. Our medicine should be our food. But to eat when you are sick is to feed your sickness. I mean, this is such a wise statement given by Hippocrates. And then look what vital statistics has done. He, you know, went back to normal foods when he got sick. There are some myths about fasting. It puts body in starvation. It deprives body of nutrients. That is indefinite fast. We all know if we fast indefinitely, ultimately we are going to die. But we are not advocating that part here. We are only looking at intermittent fasting. Maybe you can start with 12 hours of fasting. In fact, if one of you can go and talk to your parents or grandparents, look at what their lifestyle was. In fact, 99% of them will tell that they have not ever ate food after sunset. And they only had food in the morning and the evening. They never had food after sunset. Night eating was not there at all. But we are eating all in the night. Midnight snack. Because we were told to eat frequently. You know. And see, this is what it does to the body and what we eat. We eat 90%, 80% of all our foods are made from refined carbs. They said there's going to be weight loss from muscle. Yeah, if you do that, you lose muscle. There's this power from the foods. It causes hypoglycemia. No. After the intermittent fasting, I have gone up to 4 days of fast just to see whether I can take it. After the fourth day, I mean, my blood pressure and blood sugars are 84. It doesn't really cause hypoglycemia. It is all psychological. Hunger is more in the mind than physical. It's like a yo-yo diet. I mean, you do it, you skip it. But you have to make it as a part of your lifestyle. Only then things will work. And you will overwhelm with hunger and you will win. This is also not right. It's crazy. Probably it is crazy to people who do fast and live in different perspectives. And usually, people who fast is the hunger disappears after some time. And then, you know, you do create a calorie deficit, obviously. Fasting reduces plasma exercise. And that is when your counter-regulatory hormone starts kicking in. You have put a deposit into your viscera. And you would never take the deposit out. Because to take the deposit out, your insulin levels have to be low. Your counter-regulatory hormones, glucagon has to come out, your epinephrine has to come out, your growth hormone has to come out. With high levels of insulin, these don't come up at all. So, whatever goes into the deposit will always remain as deposit. And that is the problem. It reduces plasma insulin and then it helps a lot. It triggers numerous hormonal adaptations that do not happen with simple calorie reduction. Insulin drops precipitously. Help prevent insulin resistance. Noradrenaline raises, keeping metabolism high. Growth hormone raises to preserve the muscle mass. After 4 days of continuous fasting, the basal metabolism doesn't drop. Instead, it increases by around 10%. Because body needs energy, it starts mobilizing. It starts mobilizing the resources. And there was another study, 22 days of alternate daily fasting also did. In traditional three-meal thing, you have these insulin dominant state and you have insulin deficient state. And you see, if you have more insulin dominant states, then obviously you are not going to lose any fat because everything, the insulin is going to be there low. And sooner or later, you're going to become diabetic and pre-diabetic. Then there is an alternative fast where you have long periods of fasting. and then you can have dinner. Maybe if something like a 20 and 4, 20 hours of fasting and 4 hours of eating. Then you can have 8 hours, like for example, you can have 16 hours of fasting. Like you have 8 o'clock till 2 o'clock, 8 in the night to 2 in the morning. So these are various strategies one can adapt to reduce insulin secretion in the body and to make ourselves more insulin sensitive. Now, we all know bariatric surgery cures diabetes. And then we know that fasting actually works more effective than bariatric surgery in some studies. So basically here, what we need to understand is type 2 diabetes is essentially curable, which we don't realize. Basically, once they take the intermittent fasting up, it's like a bariatric surgery without the surgery, intermittent fasting. Now, coming to this calorie reduction as a primary, it is basically you don't get much weight loss. There is loss of insulin because you keep secreting insulin because you are keeping yourself a low fat and a high carbohydrate diet. And you will not have less fat loss. You will be harder to keep the weight. You will become hungrier. Your metabolic rate goes down. Your insulin is high. Your insulin resistance doesn't come down. And it always invariably these diets. Intermittent fasting, you have more weight loss, more lean mass gain, more visceral fat loss, less hunger. It being used throughout the human history and it's essentially a part of our culture. It lowers insulin, it's less insulin resistance. Almost every medical society, doctor, dietitian, mainstream media, asks you to do a low fat diet. I prefer to tell people to take the choice too. Some other alternatives like ketogenic diet, low carbohydrate diet, fat diet, all other. But why I'm not really emphasizing on it is that whatever you do, it should become a lifestyle choice. I am primarily born and brought up eating grains. And today, if I have to not to eat carbohydrate, I mean, it's very difficult for me. So I do eat carbohydrates, but I do intermittent fasting. That's where I am. For often the greatest enemy of truth is not the lie, deliberate, contrived and dishonest, but the myth, persistent, persuasive and unrealistic. Too often we hold fast to the cliches of our forebears. We subject all facts to a prefabricated set of expectations. We enjoy the comfort of opinion without the discomfort of thought. Thank you. Thank you very much.